so much for taking our sin upon you, our cross, our shame. Thank you for having the power to be resurrected, to be alive in us this afternoon. I thank you for the opportunity we have to be in this place, to sing to you, to worship you. Help us to live that life of worship the rest of this week. Help us to do that, God. We need you. Thanks for this time. Be it everything that we do in Jesus' name.
Disadvantage is everyone else in the room knows you. Matter of fact, as you shared, you talked a lot about Chris Lowry. And I want to talk to you afterwards about that. But on the serious side, I thought, how neat that Chris has had an opportunity to plant seeds and see fruit. I look forward to that time in this fellowship to be able to see God do it. And this is really exciting for me, for you, and I think for Chris. And so I asked Chris if he would take a few moments to come up here. So this will guard what you tell me later, because he's going to talk about you now. And just to share a little bit with us.
You're seem so eager to get up front.
All I ask is save me a few.
I am excited to be able to be here. We go back a long way. Kyle, we got to work with. All three of these guys worked with us on staff sometime in their past history. In fact, Angie interned with us for 3 years, three different summers. So I've not only got to work with them in student ministry, but then got to work side by side with them. And each of them has a great heart. And so it was exciting for me to be able to be a part of this. And I think about the year at Falls Creek, that both of you guys really expressed to me a call to ministry, and I'm sorry I wasn't sensitive. Brian. One of the things that we do with any student that feels called to ministry is we do a waiting period. Because if that call will go away, we want it to go away. Because a lot of people feel like they'd like to do the stage thing, but it's a lot harder to do the ministry deal. And so each of you has spent a lot of time preparing, not just that that's what I think I'd like to do. You spent a lot of time finding out that's exactly what God wants you to do. And I'm excited about that. Ministry, the two things, I would tell you the two verses. One, you used Exodus 33:11. It says that the passion of my heart in ministry has been that I could have the kind of relationship that Moses had with God. That it says the Lord spoke with Moses face to face, like a friend speaks to his friend. And I would say chase that, aim that, and try and be that. And I know each of you have a heart that would do that. The other is to stay focused, is simply to focus our life, is to love the Lord God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind. If we do that, the rest of it kind of will just fall into place. But easy? No. Fun a lot of times? No. But can I stay focused? Yes. Because when I lose that focus, and I start looking at the job, that's when it gets frustrating. That's when the personalities get crazy. That's when those kind of things start dragging down. So I just encourage you, man, keep doing that. And I know you are doing it. And when you worked here, you did that. And so I encourage you, just keep doing that. Because my experience has been, no matter what you plan, someone won't like it. Someone will do the greatest of intentions, it won't matter. Somebody's not going to be happy with you. And one of the things that you said, and I'm very impressed with, is that's reality. You can't please me. We're here to serve God, and in that, in work with people. And when our focus is right, He helps us be able to work with people. We talked about how to be filled with the Spirit. One of the things that I always loved years ago was the example that Robert McGee used of getting up, say, God, this morning, went, grabbed the tube of toothpaste, squeezed it, guess what came out? Toothpaste. Why? That's what's in it. Really deep theology. Just like this. when pressure, when life puts pressure on us, whatever's inside is going to come out. If that's me using self-discipline to try and be nice and try, well, I really think this inside, but I'm going to put this smile on my face. Guess what? Eventually it's going to come out. Some people last longer than others. Okay. But eventually it's going to come out. What you and I as ministers, what we do is we continue to try and be filled with the Spirit every day. Why? Because the Spirit is peace, love, joy, kindness, goodness. It's those things. And so when I'm filled with Him, when the pressure is put on, guess what comes out? My self-discipline? No, the Spirit. And that's how you work with people. That's how the Spirit of God uses you to impact people. Not because you're so talented, not because He's given you to do so many things, because He is so incredible that when we're filled with Him, people are impacted as that comes out of us. Those are the things I'm excited to see as you come on. Also, you join a group of people, I guess it would be like a fraternity in some ways, a group of ordained men who, years ago, when we started as ninth and, where you are, 10th and 11th graders, we started accountability with a group of y'all. And I promised I would hold you accountable for your lifetime. And then now you join some other guys who will do the same thing. It's great because you have some guys that you can call, just like we talked about before, and say, oh, I'm really struggling with this issue, how can I deal with that? Or, I've got this problem, how can I do that? What would God have me to do in that way? And then you also have a group of men who promise to come beat you up if you ever decide to do anything dumb. If you ever decide not to love your wife, I'll be at your doorstep. Okay. If you ever decide just to leave ministry for some goofy reason because it got hard or something, John will beat you up. We'll be there as your partner. I don't take this lightly, ordination. You know that, all the processes we put you through. But I also take it hard. Okay, we're brothers. And so anything that you need from me, I'll be there. Okay? Not for a year, but for the rest of your life. Okay? And then I would expect the same. So we look forward to this. We're excited about this. We're proud of you. Your church family is proud of you. Your family's proud of you. And we're excited to see what God is doing.
Let me ask this, for the benefit of all who are gathered here. This is a real dangerous thing to turn this microphone over to you. But if you will guard your time and be sensitive to the others, I'll trust you to do that. What I'd like for you to do is just come and share two things very quickly. Number one, how you came to know the Lord. You shared that already. I'd like you to share that with this larger group. Number two, that call of God on your life to His ministry. Brian, you're sitting right here at the end. If you'll just come and take just a moment and share with us.
When I was little, I was around 5-ish. Felt a tug on my heart. Knew I didn't want to go to hell. I knew I didn't. I knew that I had sin in my life. I knew that that was going to separate me from God. And so I remember Janice Gamble coming over to my house and putting a glove on my hand. Had the colors of the witness bracelet on it, and went through, understood, accepted Christ that day. I know He indwelt me, but I was 12 and some earlier. Gerald Smith did a crusade here, and when I was 12, he scared the snot out of me. And so I ran down to the front, thinking I didn't know Jesus, but I know that I did. As I look back, so that's when He came in my life. I haven't always lived the perfect life, nor will I ever, and we've been some hard times, but I was about 15 or 16. A couple of men, Chris Lowry in particular, wherever he went, he saw some stuff in me that I didn't see myself, and he pushed me, and I'm glad he did. And as of this day, what he pushed me to do has just become a passion in my life. I'm called to lead people to the presence of God, and I was telling them earlier, there's no way, I don't think there's any greater job in the world or gift to have and to lead people into the presence of the Almighty. There's no way I can understand anything else. I am passionate about it. I want other people to be passionate about it. The fact that they can have an intimate conversation, like Chris just said in Exodus 33, Moses spoke to God as one man speaks to his friend, speaks to his friend face to face. Just as I talked with some of you out there. We just talked, and that's what it's like. And that's what He wants with us. And to lead people in those encounters, corporately and also privately, just is an incredible desire I have. My life verse, and I'll close with this, is Psalms 27:4, it says, if I could get one thing, God, David said, one thing I ask, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. God, I could gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, and that I could dwell in his temple, be in his presence, just to know him. And that's just what burns within me. I want to know God. I want to know him more and more each day. That's pretty much my call, is to know God, help others know.
Around the age of five, it was Sunday night, and sermon was given, and I think I was toying around with some paper, doing whatever I did in the pews. I'm the biggest crier in the world. I cried that night, as a matter of fact. I said, God, I went up to the front, I said, I just said, God, I didn't even know what I meant. Pastor, but I went and sat down in front of the room, and my parents had loved on me and said, it's okay, because I was crying so hard. God gripped my heart. I knew I was his, I knew without a doubt. Went on, 12 years old, I was at a youth evangelism conference in Oklahoma City. They were playing People Need the Lord. I knew that other people needed the Lord, and I wanted to give my life to the ministry. I don't know why, just God put it in my heart. Came home, told my parents about it, and they knew they had a mess on their hands, and they did the way, they said, hey, you know, that's great, just see what happens, and let's pray, and whatever come about, and I know whatever's supposed to happen will, and they were real supportive of me. Since then, I've realized that we are all, as members of the body of Christ, called to serve, to minister. We're all called to serve. But some are called, as a part of the body, to be apostles and teachers, prophets, evangelists, pastors. The call in my life in ministry is that I would be a pastor, that I would equip saints for works of service, for the building up of the body of Christ. And I know that without a shadow of doubt.
Spend some time at New Life Ranch, and while there, I got to notice some things that were different in some people that wasn't in everybody. I noticed things in some of the counselors, some of the students that were there, that they had something inside them that I didn't. No, they didn't. They didn't particularly know more than I did about Christianity, but there was just something different. And after the sports class one morning, I asked the instructor, "What is it that makes you different? What is it that you have?" And he told me it was just a relationship with Jesus. And I knew right then that if all that I had known was Christianity, that wasn't enough. But I wanted what they had. And asked him how to get it. He just told me, you know, just ask Christ into your heart. And so out there on a ball field, I asked Christ into my heart. And it was a, you know, big change in my life, because I entered just not things, just knowing about them. God. I actually got to know God. And that led later in my life to, got to work at a Boy Scout camp. Tomahawk Boy Scout camp for 2 summers. And while there, I got to, since I was one of two Christians in the entire staff that was there, they asked, you know, who wants to lead the devotions on Monday and Wednesday. And me and the other guy said, okay, we will, since we're the only Christians. So I got to spend some time with this guy. He felt he was called to ministry. He was a great, you know, young man. And we got to talk and spend some time together. He got to share his heart with me. And he helped me along the way in preparing things and just for that time of doing a devotion in the morning. After I came home that summer, I got to go to summer camp with our church. And while there, I got to, as that fall shorts or pants long enough to actually go anywhere. So every time I left the building, I got sent back anyway. So I decided to stay there and got to reflect on a lot of things that week. And while reading the scripture, I came across verses that just pulled at me. One of them was Isaiah, it's Isaiah 6, where Isaiah is in the temple praying, and he has an encounter with God. And God comes down, cleanses him, and then he says, "Who will go for us? Who will go out and speak for me?" And the only answer Isaiah could give when he was faced there with God, the presence of God, was me. It's all you can give. And it came down to God asking me, "Who is going to go for me?" And the only answer that I can give is me. My call to ministry is to be faithful to that, to go wherever he leads me. Sometimes, I can't look 20 years down in the future and say, yes, this is where I want to be, because, he hasn't told me where to go. But my call is to be faithful to what he asks. Who will go for us? And that's just me.
Thank you. As you know, in the last hour, there was a meeting, and additional questions were asked. I'm going to ask Kurt Kriegel if he'll come at this time and bring that recommendation.
I'd like to ask if all the guys who are a part of that coordination council, I guess we'd call it, earlier, if you would just stand so the rest of the folks would know who it is that was a part of that. But it comes as a recommendation of joy and wholehearted sense of God's calling that we recommend to the Gracemont family, that we ordain to the gospel ministry Brian Burton, Paul Chrisman, and Kyle Jernigan.
Okay, you hear this recommendation. As a body at Gracemont Baptist Church, if you're a guest, we're thrilled you're here. But at this point, this is a vote for this body. If you are a part of Gracemont Baptist Church and you support this, would you please make it known by an uplifted hand? Okay, all opposed by like sign. And that passes without opposition. Again, that does not mean there's any special magic dust. What it does mean is that we confirm what God's been saying to you, that we see it evidenced in your life and support you. We are co-laborers in Christ together and working side by side in that call. And in just a moment, we're going to ask if you will take these seats, and we will have a time where we will lay on of hands. And again, to confirm that as a body, as a group gathered here, that we recognize that and we rejoice with you in that. Process. I do want to draw your attention for just a moment over to Acts chapter 13. In Acts chapter 13, the church is actually in a unique phase. I mentioned this morning how there are keys in each of the books, or most of the books in the Bible. In Acts, it opens up in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and says that we are to be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. Almost as a roadmap to understanding the book of Acts. When you come to the 13th chapter of Acts, it is the beginning of the uttermost. It is the start going out to the far reaches of the world. Literally, that's what ministry and the accepting of a call of being set aside is. You are saying, God, wherever, however, whomever, my life is not my own. It's been bought with a price. I've trusted in Christ as my Lord and Savior. I'm a Christian. Now beyond that, I've also surrendered in a way that that will be a priority in my life for all the days that I live. And so it's not by accident, I think, we come to the 13th chapter, the beginning of the uttermost parts of the earth, and look at those first few verses. But I really want to draw your attention to the second verse where it says, while they were worshiping, While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said to them, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and they sent them off. A couple things real quick. If you'll notice, the group that was gathered in that place were all individuals whom the Lord was using their life in a powerful way already for them to be in a place where they were really seeking the mind of the Lord in the direction of the Lord as a body worshiping. Out of that experience, out of the church, out of believers, not out of their own thought process, but out of a calling and working of God in their midst, God made it clear to set aside some for the ministry. Little did they know how far that would reach. Little did they know that when they accepted that call, it would reach a place called Tulsa, Oklahoma. Little did they know, but it did. Because it was out of that missionary endeavor the gospel went forth. And you sat here as a believer, as you've testified, as one commissioned, committed to the service of God with your life. You are results of that kind of a worship experience. You are the result of God setting people aside. You give evidence of that today, and you confirm that by others who have given their lives and have been set aside for ministry. Never, ever allow Satan to steal that seed of joy and service from you. Matter of fact, in my years of walking with the Lord, I don't know how scripturally true this is, but experientially it is, Satan gives me a lot more grief over the security of my salvation across the years than he does my call. Just remember, someone told me this years ago, God calls his own. One of the things that has given me victory over the years is this. Whenever the doubts, do I really know God? Am I walking with God? Come. I mean, remind Satan of the lie and say, wait a minute. God's called me. He calls his own to serve us. Let him confirm that, and you will be amazed how God will give you victory after victory through years just as a result of that. Once they were set aside, they went, they served, they gave their life and commitment to the Lord. And that's what you are doing and will continue to do in the areas where you have already found ministry opportunity. That will just continue to expand. They had no idea what was before them. Neither do you. In some ways, that's a good thing. In some ways, that's part of the trust and walk of faith. Finding out how it is you trust God fresh and new today, and he's faithful. He will not leave you or forsake you. But as they went, they talked about someone they knew very well. I brought something with me today. I know you won't be able to see this in the back of the room. This is an autographed picture of Scott Goodyear. I don't know, as Dee and I were talking a few moments ago, I'm not sure that Scott Goodyear, the race car driver, is a Christian. But this is an original autograph by Scott Goodyear. I can tell you that Scott Goodyear was involved in one of the closest finishes at the Indianapolis 500. Al Unser Jr. beat him out by hundredths of a second. They raced 500 miles. When it came down to it, Scott barely lost that race. I can tell you about another race just a couple years after that where Scott Goodyear, by the way, he's Canadian if you did not know that, Scott Goodyear ran a race whereby he pulled ahead of the pace car, was black flagged, refused to pull into the pits, and continued to drive, leading the race only to be disqualified because of his action. Scott Goodyear. I will also tell you that Scott Goodyear and his wife have a baby daughter. Dina was the labor and delivery nurse for that baby. I knew that he was at the hospital and Dina was the labor nurse. ESPN was trying to find where he was at. And I knew. I knew right where he was at. I could have called and told him they could have taken a camera crew like they wanted to do over to the hospital. I could have picked up a few extra dollars. I knew he was there. He autographed this picture for me. Gave it to Dina. She gave it to me. There's only one thing that I haven't told you yet. Personally, I've never met Scott Goodyear. I can tell you a lot about him. What really will capture your attention is when I know him. There is a message which you bear. It is the gospel. In all your years of walking, being sent out by God, never tell tell them about somebody you don't know. Never proclaim to them someone you haven't intimately, personally understood. Anybody can tell you about anything else, but those who have experienced it are the ones who will transform lives. You've met Jesus Christ. You know him. Never take that for granted. But tell him, reveal him, show him as you encounter him the living Lord. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for that call that you give and your faithfulness in that call. I thank you for these three men. I thank you for their hearts that beat for you. Thank you for the privilege it's been mine to get to know them a little better today. I thank you for these that have gathered here today, who are here to say, we love you, we support you, we believe in you. And we too agree that God's hand is on your life. And he's using you. Father, remind them of this day, time and again. Remind them of your call, time and again. May they experience the joy of your presence afresh every day. May they not grow weary in well-doing, but in all things may you encourage their hearts. May they be able to soar with wings like eagles. May they run and not grow weary. May they walk and not faint. May your hand be upon them and theirs. May the evidence of your presence go before them. May your grace follow behind them. And may your perfect peace be instilled on them. They are your own. You are Lord. Lead and guide and direct them, we pray. In all their steps and in all their ways. But in the journey, thank you for us having part in your work, in your call. Guide us on through this day, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Gentlemen, if you would come and have a seat here in the front. What I'd like for us to do. I'd like for us to have a few moments of silent prayer, because there are prayers on your heart as well. And just to offer them up for these, for theirs. And then after we have that time of prayer before the Lord in our hearts, then I'm going to ask us to pray, or you would lead us in that prayer. Pray for God's blessings on these that God has set apart, and we have an opportunity. Close out our time of ordination service together, Lord. Let's bow and spend some moments before the Lord today.
experience times like this that truly are a joy in ministry. The joy of being a part of your body, of seeing how you work in the lives of individuals, and how you call some out to be ministers in a way that is unique. Father, I thank you for each one that's here. Thank you for Brian and for his love. Father, I thank you for Kyle. Thank you for his heart, for his love for you, his desire to pastor your people, to be a shepherd. Thank you for his heart to reach out to men, to all those who need a saving knowledge of you. Father, I pray too you would keep that passion alive in his heart, that you would use him in ways that would just be evidence of you being at work. Father, we pause to lift these men up to you as you call them out to serve you. Father, I just pray that you would give each one of them the strength to live a life that's worthy of the calling. But Father, in the times that come, that you would be their strength. In the way that you have worked the best. We thank you for the celebration of this moment. We look forward to what the future holds. And may we, as the Grace Hunt family, be a people who lift these men and their families, their wives, up to you on a regular basis. That we would be a source of strength, a source of encouragement for them. And again, we just want to give you all the praise.
Fellowship, there's some refreshments that you can put out, and I do hope that you will stick around for a few moments to be able just to share and chat with these individuals, share with them your joy for them. It's been good to be a part of this today. We have something special that we want to mark this day. We want to share with you that you will be able to look back upon. We have a certificate. We have Bibles that I know as years go by you will look at and remember. Paul, you would come please. God bless you. Church family. fellowship. It's a joy for me to present this. God bless you. Right? My joy, my privilege to present to you this is your church family fellowship. God bless you. Times like these, we understand the heart of the body in Christ. Let's all stand. Let's bow as we close and bless the refreshments in our time together. Can we do so? Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the blessings of this day. Go with us, we pray, in the power, in the name of our Lord and Savior.